So, I've always liked spiders.
My favorite stuffed animal as a kid, Spidey, was a spider, and I got him when I was like 3. When I was a kid, I always said I'd be an entomologist, like in every school project, even though I really dislike most bugs that aren't spiders. I don't know if you have the option of just studying spiders. And I kind of gave up on entomology when I went to the Academy of Sciences Museum, and I saw that the whole entomology wing was like entirely dead spiders on cork boards, which I don't really know if that's representative of the field, but that was the message I got at that age. But anyway, they're still my favorite animal. I like their big hairy bodies and how many legs they have. I just think it's funny that they have so many legs. I'm going to admit it crossed my mind once or twice, just a fleeting thought, like, I wonder what's the biggest spider I could get. The Ferrari of plush spiders. Enter FAO Schwarz. For those who aren't familiar, FAO Schwarz is a now extinct toy store chain with high-end toys for rich kids. But the presentation of FAO Schwarz was everything. They were basically like little theme parks. Just going to them was fun, even if you didn't get anything. They had a theme song and animatronics.
Here's a tree that talks.
Things to touch and feel and more. Cars and games for girls and
this truly magical talking tree brings joy and excitement to everyone who sees it. It was custom manufactured for FAO Schwarz retail stores. This magnificent talking tree is bound to make a grand statement and mesmerize all who see it. The possibilities are endless. With its animated eyes, mouth, and an adorable moving raccoon, it will become the center of attention.
Everyone was different with a different theme. So the one near me as a kid was the one in San Francisco, and they had like a Jack and the Beanstalk theme with huge giant feet that stomped and like an animatronic goose and a harp. I looked online for footage of this location and there's like none. There aren't even any still photos, which is super sad. But there is a little bit to be found of the New York and Las Vegas locations, so I will be showing you that. Part of the way they enticed kids to buy toys was by showing them all in this happy little toy kingdom. The baby dolls came from a real nursery, the plush toys lived in a plush toy jungle, and each brand display had whimsical jumbo versions of popular kids' toys. By the way, somebody is going to correct me that no, FAO Schwarz isn't extinct because it reopened in New York City. But I went to the New York reincarnation last November and it was bad. Totally didn't capture the spirit of it. Like, it's still an expensive toy store, but it just kind of looks like an expensive toy store. The whimsy is pretty absent from it. Can we talk about the current minimalism trend and how it carries over to toy stores? Like, Toys R Us is coming back, but now it's going to be a streamlined warehouse where you order the toys off screens and get them shipped to your house. As if digital catalogs are a good way to market to a demographic that doesn't understand delayed gratification or object permanence. Anyway, FAO Schwarz is kind of famous for their gigantic plush toys, which seem mostly to be used in stores like an aspirational display. I'm sure you can see where this is going. Kids go in and are dazzled by the idea that any child would own a life-sized Brontosaurus plush, and then they go and get a normal-sized Brontosaurus plush, which still costs like $60 because it's FAO Schwarz, and then they go home. So last year I learned that in 2007, FAO Schwarz released a Harry Potter tie-in collection of luxury toys, including oversized plush of some of the film's characters. The lineup consisted of a 3-foot Fluffy the Three-Headed Dog, a 12-foot Hungarian Horn-Tailed Dragon, a life-sized Buckbeak the Hippogriff, a life-sized Fox the Phoenix, and hilariously, a 3-foot Hedwig the Owl.
Did you see the owl?
I don't know, something about making Hedwig impractically large, larger than an owl would ever be, was just extremely funny to me. Finally, the collection included Aragog, the giant spider, measuring 66 inches from toe to toe. The biggest plush spider that I personally have ever heard of. I searched the footage for this giant spider displayed in store, and it looks like they mainly suspended him from the wall or ceiling, so it looks like he's dropping down on a web to gobble you up. But I also found a couple pictures of him, like, posed behind velvet ropes, and this completely amazing one of him looming over an escalator. I found out about this spider last year, but as you can imagine, it comes up for sale very rarely. It's a magical combination of factors where I assume few were made, few were sold, and of those, few survived. Then a couple months ago, I saw one go up for sale, and I was like, come on, Jenny, you don't need a giant spider. But I recently hit 500,000 subscribers on YouTube, which I consider a pretty special occasion. And hey, I did bookmark that spider listing, and for some reason it never sold. So yeah, I messaged the seller and committed to buy this giant spider. The best celebration I could possibly imagine. Here's the next problem. The spider was in Arizona,
And if I wanted it, I had to go get it. And we're in a global pandemic. And Arizona is currently one of the least cautious and most affected states in the country. So, you know, I'm not going to not get the spider, but I have to be very cautious about how I get the spider. So it's time for a spider quest. Let me walk you through the steps in a convenient numbered list. Step one, round up all the friends I have who have already been exposed to COVID, including one who is willing to drive the whole way, thank God. Step two, fill a cooler with snacks so you don't have to stop at rest stops. I also had to pack other essentials, like some great reading about Arizona, extra camera batteries and memory cards, my wallet with all my ID and credit cards. And finally, the spider had to be paid for in cash, and I was worried about carrying that much money around on a road trip. So I cleverly disguised the envelope so no one would open it and hid it somewhere that no one would ever look. Step three, make a themed playlist of songs about spiders.
Yes! Right. It's called My Spider.
Step four, pre-plan rest breaks, and if you absolutely have to stop, do it somewhere that is empty with a low population. We stopped in Oatman, an old western town with feral donkeys.
Oh, there's two of them!
It's an old donkey! Oh my god, we should roll down the window and say hi to it! Okay, I'm just gonna roll down the window and just see what it does. Just organically. Oh! Hi! Oh my god. It's so friendly. It's not even really trying to get food. You're so friendly. Okay, now it's kind of trying to eat my hand, but just in like a horse way, not in like an aggressive way. They had a lot of cute little shops, and you wouldn't think it from the outside, but they also sell some really beautiful lingerie. Step five, book your overnight stops at socially distanced locations. Our first night, I found this place called the Canyon Motel and RV Park, and I chose it because not only are you not in a hotel building with other guests, you can actually book a night stay inside a real train car. My sister and I stayed in Caboose Number 2, which is supposedly haunted by the ghost of an old switchman who walks the car swinging his lantern at night. I always think it'll be fun to book haunted hotels and then toss and turn all night afraid of ghosts. But it was cool staying in an authentic sleeper car. I turned on my white noise app because I already have a preset that's train noises, so that was another level of realism. Another reason I chose the train motel is that it's down the road from the remains of Bedrock City.
Get your very own dinosaur operator's license when you visit Bedrock. We'll teach you everything you need to know to become an expert dinosaur operator. Just like me. Yabba-dabba-doo!
Bedrock City was actually a chain of multiple Flintstone theme parks. There was one in South Dakota and one in British Columbia. Those ones had walk-around mascots and animatronics and, you know, trees. The one in Arizona was the least elaborate of all of them, but it was also the longest surviving one. It officially closed last year in 2019, but even before that, it had been up for sale for a while. It was managed for years by the widow of the guy who built it, and she really just wanted to retire after a certain point, so it was in extreme disrepair long before it closed. It's also kind of generous to call it a theme park. It was basically a themed playground. It had concrete shells of various Flintstone buildings, which you could walk around and take pictures in. When it was still operational, it also had a theater playing Flintstones cartoons all day, and a little train ride through a volcano. The most iconic fixture was the big Brontosaurus slide, which you would climb up and then you'd slide down the tail like your Fred Flintstone when he clocks out from work. The park was recently purchased by new owners who had a lifelong dream of opening a sanctuary for birds of prey. They've renamed the property Raptor Ranch, which when I first heard it, I was like, dinosaur theme park? But no, it's not a dinosaur theme park. By the time we rolled into town for the night, they'd already been closed for like an hour, but we decided to drive over and just scope it out from the outside. Wait, where? I don't see him yet. Oh, there he is. Yabba-dabba-doo.
Blocked off from it.
No! My impression from my research was that it was a big informal RV park and we could just walk right up to it, but it was actually all encircled by a big wall.
I see an old building. Look at that blue thing. That's an old Flintstone building.
Umbrella.
An old Flintstone umbrella. And I see Dino. It's Dino!
But we saw a guy drive up and walk right into the closed gift shop, so I was like, I'll just go inside.
Man, I just want to inquire.
Oh yeah, they're closed. Let's sign off.
So we went in and just figured I'd ask how many fixtures they still had to decide if it was worth coming back before we left in the morning. Oh, check out the one other guy in the shop calling me a fake Flintstones fan.
You probably didn't even watch a Flintstones movie. kid.
I did.
I mean, I watched Flintstones, so he is wrong, but I don't really like Flintstones. I'm more of an abandoned theme park fan. So anyway, I asked the owner how much of the park was still left, and she was like, oh, it's all still back there. And I was like, what? Like, oh my God, we have to come back tomorrow. And she was like, oh, well, I'm still here. You can just go in now if you want.
Oh my God.
So we literally got free rein to go around the park and it was closed. So we had the whole place to ourselves. And yeah, it's all still back there.
It's all still here.
Oh my God, the
Brontosaurus. Oh! Okay, yeah.
Apparently the initial plan was to bulldoze Bedrock, but when they saw how nostalgic it was for people, they decided to leave a lot of the surviving fixtures intact. They even have a thing on their website where if you had pictures at the park as a kid, they want you to retake a picture there as an adult and like send it in.
There is stuff in here. It's kind of eerie, isn't it? Oh, eerie. Oh, if I saw a figure of a character, I would die.
I think once Raptor Ranch has taken its final form, any ties to the actual Flintstones brand will be gone, but they said they intend on keeping the iconic Brontosaurus slide and a lot of the vehicles. They've also started repurposing a lot of the existing caveman-shaped building shells into the bird enclosures, so you can still get the flavor of the original park, but then you peer in the building and there's like an owl living inside.
Looking where? Yeah. A bird sanctuary? It's a Flintstone house that's now... Oh! It's an owl. Wow. Hoo-hoo! Hoo-hoo! It's a beautiful owl. A Flintstone.
If we'd been there during its actual operating hours, we could have seen a Birds of Prey show demonstrating different behaviors. So if you're a fan of big birds or abandoned theme parks or, you know, both, definitely stop by here sometime.
What is it? What is it? What is it? Big snake.
Yeah. I wouldn't crawl into that thing.
Oh, I'm crawling in that snake.
You are nuts.
It's full of cockroaches.
No, it's not. I'm just gonna look.
It's recording, right?
And then you just crawl deep, deep in the snake. Okay, so here's... Steve, sit down and get your hair done.
I don't feel safe.
No, actually, maybe don't do that. Looks like a church in here. It's the altar of Fred. Ooh! Big teeth. That's cool. Jump, jump, jump. Oh my God! Oh my God!
Oh my!
That scared the bejesus out of me. Oh my God! And I warned you. I wasn't ready for that. There's another mannequin in here. It's Betty Rubble. Oh my God! Oh, this is bad vibes. The way she's leaning. Oh. Jen and Angie's epic road trip adventure, June 2019. That's so cute. Oh, I'm gonna guess this was some kind of Flintstone gadget that would like be a TV for them or something. Or it's a clock, I guess. Case with a shark creature. I assume this is like their pantry. Little shell there. It's open. I'm just gonna take a little peek inside. How scary, right? Scary. The door's creaking in like a way that's kind of scary. Oh, and something's cooking. Yum. Wonder what this was part of. Oh my God. We're in like a tropical volcano. Oh, and there's a, maybe this used to move. Yeah, this probably used to glow. And then these probably used to twirl so they would fly. I hope Lola and Steve are enjoying this. Because I am. This is more than I even imagined it would be.
It's right next to the Grand Canyon. We literally went here instead of the Grand Canyon. I mean, I've been there before. I think it's better than the Grand Canyon. That's my hot take. Put that quote on the website. I'll take the snake tunnel and the big Fred Flintstone billboard any day.
Yabba dabba doo means welcome to you. Beautiful.
Oh, also, you better believe I slid down the big iconic Brontosaurus slide.
Oh my God! It is really steep. I'm kind of scared.
Yabba dabba do it.
Yabba
Step 6, acquire spider. When we got to our meeting place for our spider dealer, it was 108 degrees outside, which was absolutely horrific.
Oh, there he is.
What? Hi.
Oh my god, it's big. Oh my god, it's a big spider.
It's so large. Can I hold it? Oh, it is.
Oh my god.
Aragog is so large and beautiful. I asked his former owner for his origin story, and apparently he and some of the other big Harry Potter plush were purchased by a large bookstore in town for a display in the children's section. The display was there for years, but kids were scared of Aragog, and they received countless complaints from moms to move or get rid of the big spider. My spider dealer bought it from them, and it's been waiting for an interested buyer ever since. So, that's me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
I'm going to make him wave goodbye. He kind of looks like he's doing
it.
Look at him. Look at this spider. He's really happy.
Oh my god, yes, that's what I wanted.
It's working. I'm going to pull him through from the other side.
Oh my god.
Look at him. Look at him.
Once we had Aragog, we went to our next overnight accommodation, which was, for me, one of the highlights of the trip. This is the Tombstone Monument Ranch, and it's basically a tiny western town, like Frontierland at Disneyland or Knott's Berry Farm. But it's a private ranch and a hotel. So the little storefronts you see actually are the hotel rooms. The rooms inside are surprisingly big and recently updated, and they have porches with rocking chairs out front so you can rock and pretend you're in a tiny western town. It was also nice to stay at a hotel that had one of those devices for pulling cowboy boots off your feet, as well as about 20 hooks to hang your cowboy hat. They also have a dining room and a themed operating saloon. We liked this place so much we actually ended up staying an additional night, and I'm sure it's bustling outside of a pandemic, but as of right now it was great for social distancing. I think at any given time across our visit we were one of like two parties on the whole property, so we basically had it to ourselves, which meant I was also able to take Aragog out on the town and show him a good time. I mean, honestly, I probably would have done this if the place was full too.
Wow.
Oh my god.
I was like, what
did
she got?
No.
Yeah, so we just sold all the stuff and just moved down here and started a new life. And,
oh my goodness.
I do this. I love it. I watch lots of YouTube videos and all the stuff.
How many employees are there?
Yeah. Well, looky here.
Are you with your spider?
Yeah. They have a whole herd of horses on property, and there was an option to book activities like trail rides, shooting, or archery. I could imagine a big family booking the whole place out for like a family reunion and staying a whole week, but we were trying to be as no contact as possible, so we didn't do the activities. We just kind of wanted to chill there, and it definitely made me feel like I was staying overnight at a little theme park. Plus, it was out in the middle of the actual desert, so we got to see a real tarantula.
A real tarantula. Is it still there? Oh, good.
Oh.
Oh my god! I can't believe it. It's a real tarantula. Oh, it looks so good.
This ranch was a 2-mile drive from Tombstone, the famous cowboy town. Tombstone was pretty sparse too, so we were fully able to walk around the main street and look around. However, not all the businesses in town are committed to social distancing, and one of them even said not to wear masks because they believe in free speech. So, you know, if you find yourself there, proceed with caution. We did take in one of the last emptiest showings of the gunfight show, which was extremely earnest and just great.
What? Enough about me. How is respectable business treating you?
Doc, Tombstone's a place to be. It's like you can pluck the money right off the trees around here.
And they had a knockoff Haunted Mansion exhibit, which you got to go through alone with just your group. It was incredible.
Go to Boot Hill Cemetery.
Wow.
Boot Hill was so named since
it's
many
Taylor
people
Swift.
Buried there.
Wow. I like that the cemetery is the mini golf course. Mm-hmm. Don't shoot until you can see the whites of his eyes.
Thank you so much.
my god.
And of course, everybody had to get cowboy hats. So that was the spider quest. As of recording time, the entire spider posse has completed a self-imposed 14-day quarantine, and none of us had any symptoms, so I guess it worked. And now I've got Aragog, my big, beautiful spider. Oh god. This was the closest to like vloggy content I've ever done, and you shouldn't get used to it, but it was a special occasion. This is really heavy. This whole video was just my 500k special. I'm not gonna put that in the title. I feel like nobody actually clicks a video called 500k special because they assume you're just gonna like sit in your room and do an announcement video or something, and this was not that. So if you're one of my 500,000 subscribers, thank you for subscribing, and if you're not, I don't know, go away. This video wasn't for you. Oh, or subscribe. That's what I should have said there. Subscribe. 500. By the way, none of the places I showed in the video know that I have a YouTube channel. We weren't sponsored or like comped by anyone. They were just all genuinely cool places to go, which is why I put their business name in the video. Finally, I bought my spider secondhand, the ethical way to purchase a giant spider. But because it was originally a Harry Potter product, I will be making a donation equivalent to the price of the spider to a trans charity. I picked the Okra Project, which provides free meals to people experiencing food insecurity. I will also be putting a link to them. So if you haven't heard of them, maybe check them out and consider donating yourself.
Just like Radiator Springs racers.
It is!
Oh my god, you're right.
We should be playing the score from that ride.
Oh, oh no. Did you have to speed up going up the hill?
No, you don't.
Be happy that we are not on the outer lane.
We should listen to the Spirit Stallion of the Cimarron soundtrack.
For you.
Yes!
If Vegas was on the way back, I was gonna go marry him, but we'll have to... I have to think something else good to do with him. He's very large.
Yeah, he's very, very large.